Hey everybody, it's Party Elite, and today we're taking a look at the upcoming 4X strategy game, Humankind. In development for some time now, with a bunch of gameplay fully on display through its OpenDev approach to development, Humankind is most easily compared to Civilization, though it does plenty to set itself apart from it. I've had the chance to play the game multiple times through its development, and now finally, with a review key sent to me by the developers, I've been able to have the full experience. It's given me an opportunity to really get dug in with the game, its concepts, its ideas, and its mechanics, and it's given me the opportunity to find its strengths and weaknesses. If, after watching this review, you decide you'd like to grab the game for yourself, you can do so at my game store linked in the description down below to support the channel as you buy, but do keep in mind it's available with Xbox Game Pass as well if you're so inclined. Now, without further ado, let's see if the folks at Amplitude Studios manage to push Humankind far enough. In Humankind, you lead a people from the days of wandering as a nomadic hunter-gatherer tribe in the Neolithic era to the contemporary era, flinging nuclear warheads and building museums that dig up the very things you once used to coexist with. Speaking of the mammoth exhibit, not the dinosaurs, of course. This isn't an uncommon theme in games like this, but with Humankind, rather than picking a nation to play as from start to finish with a preset series of special abilities, specializations, buffs, and debuffs, you're building your own nation as an amalgamation of different cultures through the eras, with each culture applying its own subtle touch to the end result. See, in Humankind, you're crafting your own civilization in a way that references how it happened for many a people throughout our real world history. As you enter each era, you're given an opportunity to pick from one of 10 real world cultures, or to stay as the culture you played as in the previous era, as long as it wasn't the Neolithic era. Apart from the Neolithic era, there are 6 eras that each have 10 cultures to pick from, and each of these cultures have their own unique units and districts, and they also have unique legacy traits that follow you through every following era, alongside a classification or an affinity, something that can change from era to era, giving access to an affinity-specific set of passive and active abilities. The cultural identity of a civilization is not a static thing over the course of several millennia, and that's what Humankind is getting at with the shifting cultures over the years, allowing you as a player to be influenced by your needs, the resources you have access to, and the circumstances you're dealing with, so that you can adapt over the years, just as the various cultures in human history have. The Normans were a blend of Norse and Frankish people. Mughals were a blend of Mongols and Persians. Romans and Greeks clearly share cultural similarities. With that said, where you came from is never forgotten, as those legacy traits I mentioned continue to provide you benefits as you move from era to era, unlocking new levels of the tech tree as you do. Now, a quick note. In previous builds of the game, you'd move through the eras very quickly while still researching technologies of prior eras. You could literally be in the, you know, industrial age, still trying to figure out how to build roads. I'm almost barely being hyperbolic here, but these have been adjusted to make things a bit more appropriate. Science moves a lot quicker, and era stars are harder to acquire. Now, I only mention this because it was a very common and major issue that many had during the closed beta, myself included, so I do want to mention that it has been addressed, and it does feel like you're progressing through eras and technologies in a more sensible and logical fashion, and I'm really happy to see that. Now, back to the topic at hand, though. To get from era to era, you need to accomplish a variety of tasks to unlock era stars. These tasks are spread out across the different affinity types, and they'll all come through sort of naturally over the course of a game. But you'll sometimes want to focus on specific stars to speed up how quickly you can go from era to era, and also to maximize your acquisition of fame. See, every era star you acquire gives you some fame, with the era stars that line up with your current culture's affinity giving you significantly more. And fame is the ultimate deciding factor at the end of a game of Humankind. The most famed culture is declared the winner. Beyond era stars, there are competitive deeds that grant fame as well, having you be the first to set foot on a new continent, the first to discover writing, the first to circumnavigate the globe, and much, much more. Building wonders, being the first to discover natural wonders, and researching certain higher-level technologies also grant you fame. So, ultimately, the game isn't about getting to the end faster or necessarily being the last one standing. It's about being the greatest there ever was. Will you be remembered? That's what matters with cultures. That's what matters with civilizations. Will you be remembered for anything that's not just surviving to the end. Between the very heart of this concept and the inclusion at launch of often ignored cultures, Humankind already has a leg up, in my books at least. For one, how many games out there expose people to the Aksumites or the Haudenosaunee or the Khmer Empire? As somebody whose love of history was born out of the video games I played as a kid, I absolutely love seeing these opportunities taken to showcase and learn about cultures that we don't often see represented. It's really great to see they didn't just go with the expected. They really took some unexpected turns, and I gotta give points for that. But beyond that, Humankind's focus on fame and cultural transitions through the eras makes it a game very much about storytelling. I'm a big fan of that, and if you're familiar with this channel, you'll know this. It's a huge point of appeal for me, but it does come with its caveats that we'll touch on in just a little bit. But I digress. In the Neolithic era, you're hunting and gathering and wandering around looking for a place to settle when you manage to get enough era stars to get into the ancient era, the first era in which you're actually able to build cities. Once there, you'll be building districts on the various hexes around your cities, trying to exploit the land around you, while infrastructure buildings won't take any tiles, but will provide modifiers and benefits to the city and its districts. You'll be recruiting units to explore, do battle, and claim more territory with, building outposts to make clear what you consider rightfully yours, sometimes upgrading said outposts to cities, sometimes attaching them to an existing city to give it more territory to exploit and expand into. You'll manage population focuses, you'll pick things to research, and you'll try to keep your people happy and alive. A lot of this will look and feel familiar to fans of the genre, and though a city or outpost automatically establishing a border based on the territory it's established in might be a little different than the norm, it isn't an unfamiliar concept either. The expansion of these cities into metropolis status over the course of a playthrough is really a sight to behold, and there's a pretty satisfying feeling seeing remnants of cultures in your past sticking around centuries after you've moved on, like literally grabbing a slice at the Pizza Hut across the street from the Pyramids of Giza. This is actually a thing, by the way. There's a Pizza Hut not, like, I don't know, 100 feet away from the Pyramids of Giza, and that juxtaposition is really well represented in Humankind on the campaign map, and it just feels so real in that way, you know? Now, these layers of the game, expanding and exploiting, are very well executed, I would say. Districts, particularly those that help generate food, industry, money, and science, have adjacency bonuses that you'll try to take advantage of, asking you to puzzle together the ideal spread of districts based on the terrain and aforementioned adjacency bonuses while ensuring a city doesn't grow too big too quickly and start to get unstable, potentially triggering rebellions and revolutions if left unchecked. These districts are nicely varied too. You won't just pop down a couple farms and call it a day, you're limited by time, space, and stability, so you'll need to plan your approach and at times again adapt to evolving scenarios, trying to take advantage of, you know, cultural bonuses, trying to take advantage of unique adjacency bonuses. It really is quite nicely put together. Some districts provide defensive bonuses when fighting, others allow you to recruit units at their location, and some are needed to acquire certain units, like aircraft or missiles. Between this, infrastructure that provides improvements without hurting stability or taking up space, and the ability to expand a city across multiple massive territories, you'll start to see very early on strategic decisions like placing fortifications at choke points and on the high ground, or building spawn points as potential forward operating bases for future conflicts. The near immediate access to such a grand swath of land gives you more options to think about as a player, especially for things that don't need to be built adjacent to an existing district, such as garrisons, train stations, aerodromes, etc., etc., and at the same time, you'll be trying to expand in the direction of particularly fruitful tiles for districts that do have to be placed adjacent to others. And as you're doing all this, you'll not only come across other cultures doing the same, but you'll start to develop more facets of your people, too. A civilization isn't simply its culture. The laws and ideologies feature in the conversation, too. Influence is generated over time in various ways and is in turn used for a multitude of things, including making decisions as they pertain to your people's civics. Influence can be spent to make civic decisions across a variety of topics, which are spread out over multiple categories. The catch is that, though the civic options are the same in every playthrough, you won't necessarily see them all in every playthrough, as the decision isn't even available to you if you haven't accomplished certain tasks. For example, unless you raise a standing army, you won't need to make a decision about how your military is structured. If you're only playing a single city run, never establishing a second city, there are some civic decisions that you'll never be able to make because your people wouldn't think of it. The decision on what to do with people of a different faith can't come up unless you've met people of a different faith. The same goes for what happens to the cultures of conquered people. I love how this is executed, as it allows for different approaches in different playthroughs, and it makes perfect sense. If you've never been exposed to a concept, how can you make a decision about it? Beyond that, the civics you choose will shift the ideologies of your people across a few categories. The harder they lean in one direction or another, the more benefits of a certain kind you'll glean, but it'll come at the cost of stability in your cities. Ideologies also determine how well you get along with others you meet. Sharing ideologies makes it harder to declare war on another, while having opposing ideologies makes it that much easier. This is reflected in-game in a way that is enriching without getting in the way of player agency. Religion is a major factor as well, of course, with civilizations being able to establish their own faiths, building holy sites to help spread said faith, and potentially using said spread of faith as a way to justify wars as well, something that can be done with the spread of culture too. As a faith grows through the ages, it can adopt new tenets, which in turn unlock greater buffs, the option to build more holy sites, and more. Religion isn't just some throwaway set of buffs, it can be used as a tool, though I do wish it were a bit more involved outside of when you gain a new tenet. It has little bearing on the gaining of era stars or fame, and it would have been nice to see it tie in a bit more. Eventually, as culture, faith, and borders spread, you'll start to meet others, and you'll start to engage in diplomacy. Overall, diplomatic communications are relatively simple. You have a few tiers of trade available, you can share maps, you can open or close borders, you can sign non-aggression pacts, eventually escalating to alliances, which unlock a few more treaty options, but again, nothing too complex. You're able to buy goods that you need, luxury resources for various buffs and increased stability, and strategic goods for the option to build certain units. And of course, just as you're able to buy goods, your neighbors are able to buy your goods from you as well, earning you a little bit of money. Controlling resources is absolutely a way to gain an upper hand over your enemies. Can you imagine, for example, the Mongols without any horses? Despite how simple peacetime diplomacy is, the lead-up to, the declaration of, and the fighting of a war is really something else. War is interesting in that it uses the concept of war support. You need to generate a loathing among your people for another people through grievances and demands. Border skirmishes while at peace, the claiming of an adjacent territory, seeing people of your faith or culture living under the control of a foreign sovereign, all of this gets your people incensed, helping increase war support over time, and as you make demands of reparations, and as those demands get refused or accepted, you'll see that war support bubbling on both sides of the equation. And once that war support crosses a threshold, you can declare a justified war. Now, keep in mind you can declare an unjustified surprise war as well without reaching that threshold, but your war support will trickle down over time as your people are upset at this seemingly pointless war you're fighting, and that can spell trouble since the first one to have their war support hit zero immediately loses the war, and you'll find yourself fighting the enemy quite literally while fighting your own people's desire in a metaphorical sense represented through a dwindling war support. Through victories in battles, conquests of cities, and forcing the enemy to retreat from battles, you can bring their war support right down to zero and push forward any demands based on your war support when the war was declared and where it sits at the end of the war. In this way, war is methodical, and the wiping out of another people can rarely be done over the course of just one war, though you can vassalize your enemies somewhat easily, having full access to their resources and help from them in wars, unless and until they decide to declare independence. I really like the idea of war support. It's directly affected by ideological proximity, and it makes war declaration a bit more of an effort. In effect, you're generating a casus belli to go to war. Unfortunately, I do find it a little too easy to accrue war support. Border skirmishes aren't all that hard to come by, and grievances are plentiful, especially in the later eras, where breathing in the wrong direction will trigger a slew of grievance notifications. I think if war support decayed more quickly or was overall slower or harder to acquire, it could be made a bit more interesting than it already is, and it is already pretty interesting. Now, do note that player agency in declaring war whenever they want isn't removed here. If you just want to declare a war, you can. The punishment for it isn't all that bad, you just have to adapt and accept that you might just be a bit of a jingoistic warmonger. fighting the wars themselves is also just a fantastic experience. Armies travel around as stacks of units, and when one of your stacks engages another stack, or vice versa, you get a battle. Now, you don't necessarily have to be enemies. Two neutral stacks who don't have a non-aggression pact signed between their people can engage in battle as long as they're in neutral territory. This is what's referred to as a border skirmish, a very real thing that does happen without an open declaration of war. And it's really cool to see this represented in Humankind. Again, they've taken all these very interesting concepts and translated them into gameplay mechanics in very interesting ways. And border skirmishes between neutral armies in neutral territory is just another one of those things. Anyway, I digress again. So battles are actually fought as turn-based tactical battles on the campaign map itself. It's not like Age of Wonders where you're teleported to a battle map. It's not like Civilization where the stacks just swing at each other. No. Units spread out over the battlefield, the size of which is determined by how many units are fighting. And while you can auto-resolve battles that you don't want to fight, you can choose to fight them yourself too, moving and attacking, taking advantage of terrain, flanking, special abilities, and more as you try to either destroy the enemy's army or defend or capture the flag, depending on if you're the defender or attacker in a battle. Siege battles are spread over the entire city. All of its built-up adjacent districts are dragged into the battle when it begins, but first, if there are walls built, the attacker might want to build siege equipment to help break the walls and cause damage as well. After all, cavalry can't climb walls and they provide a massive defensive buff. These city battles can be huge given how large cities can get, and the regular land and naval battles can be absolutely massive too, spanning half a continent in later eras when you're running around with muskets, cannons, and a man of war or two, and then it gets even bigger when you've got automatic rifles and aircraft and all sorts of artillery and just, that's absolutely, it's impressive. It's very impressive. Now, multiple stacks can join in battle together, and if things are looking grim, you can send in additional stacks to reinforce a battle too. Larger battles will last multiple turns, with multiple rounds in each turn, and over the course of 3 or 5 or so turns of a battle, you might be able to bring a couple of stacks into a battlefield to turn things around where you were previously losing. Airstrikes and artillery bombardments can provide help from outside a battlefield too, and let's not forget the various districts I mentioned previously, as well as the option to pre-establish choke points and otherwise use the terrain to your advantage, from height to forests to river crossings, everything giving a buff or debuff to unit combat strength as you try to match spears to cavalry or as you try to take advantage of unique cultural units' special traits while avoiding the very same of your enemies. Battles can get very involved, especially when they start to get amphibian, requiring a mix of naval and land forces to guarantee victory. I don't think I've ever really fought a dull battle in Humankind. There's been one or two where my enemy was technologically outmatched, but even then, there's a fun to maneuvering and systematically destroying your enemies in order to gain your soldiers some veterancy, giving them names, and marching them off to the next battle more capable than before. There are some really, really cool units in the game too, from your typical swords and tanks and the like to Secret Service agents and guerrilla fighters who can do things like stay hidden unless an enemy is adjacent to them. Some units have traits that can cause trouble instead for yourself, like the very capable samurai who refuse to ever retreat, no matter the circumstances. Battles in Humankind are quite possibly my favorite from the genre. They're really engaging, with tons of moving parts of their own inside a much greater machine of a game. And it really is a massive machine, Humankind. There are so many little details that make it stand out. Wonders are claimed when you gain enough influence to do so, and this ensures that nobody else can sneakily build it before you're done, stealing it from you despite your investment. This also means, however, that you need to build the one you've claimed before you're able to claim another. Independent people are like city-states in Civilization, but your affinity to them changes based on your dealings with them as well as your ideological proximities and collective history. For example, if you let stability in a city drop too much for too long, you might see a rebellion, and that rebellious army might settle down and they'll never want to talk to you. I also just love the narrative events that trigger based on your actions, further adding differences between playthroughs, ranging from great floods to superstitions to traveling merchants and much more that sometimes give you minor to mid-sized benefits, while at other times cause entire ideological shifts for your people depending on the scale of the decision. The Avatar Builder is an interesting concept as well, allowing you to make your own avatar and give it personality traits, some of which you have to unlock through actions in-game over time. Then you can share these avatars and your friends can use these avatars as enemy AI, and the way you've built them and the personality traits you've given them will translate into in-game actions. It's a really cool sort of meta conversation outside of gameplay, so to speak, and it's a nice touch. I wouldn't say it's a huge selling point, not as much as they kind of made it out to be at first, but it is an interesting little extra, I would say. It's a, I guess you could call it a light bit of progression if you're so inclined, and it's fun to, you know, share this kind of interaction with friends and all, but again, nothing to really, I would say, write home about, even though I'm writing about it right now, I guess. Now, like any massive machine, Humankind isn't without room for improvement. There are a couple of issues, for example, with balancing, and this is a tough thing to tackle because, in a way, the asymmetry works as it pertains to storytelling. As I said earlier, I love it, but it comes with caveats. I quite like the idea of coming across a people that are overwhelmingly powerful compared to what you're used to, and then needing to overcome it in some way. It's happened in real-world history, and it happens in Humankind. I've met this imbalance a few times here and there, but it never quite frustrated me as much as just became a thing to overcome, to be challenged by, and again, those of you familiar with the channel know that I derive a lot of enjoyment from that kind of challenge. I quite like that, but I understand some will most certainly not, and that's why I wanted to mention it. I also find that religion is a relatively flimsy set of systems. There isn't too much going on at all, and without it being integrated to the core era stars and their fame generation, it feels like an add-on rather than an intrinsic element. Now, religion has been improved from the beta and the prior OpenDev build, so do keep that in mind. However, I still feel like it could be doing a bit more, and it could be, well, just a bit more involved. Espionage and subterfuge are non-existent despite how crucial they've been throughout history, and though I understand that they were maybe excluded to prevent bloating a game that's already full of so many mechanics, I can't help but feel that this is an important one through the ages and worth including. Diplomacy itself also again feels a little too simple. There are only a handful of interactions you can make, and you'll often find yourself doing the exact same set of things, just, well, just 'cause. Having a vassal is actually particularly disappointing. Sure, they'll join you in wars and stuff, and they actually do participate, which was nice to see, but you can't really manage your relationship with them. You can't give them more freedoms to prevent a war of independence, they don't make demands of you before jumping to that same independence conclusion, declaring a war rather than, you know, trying to have a conversation first, and you can't even antagonize them or tell them specifically what to do in war. It just feels like once they're your vassal, you can kind of ignore them until they eventually, perhaps inevitably, declare a war of independence. Just not that interesting. As much as mingling of culture and faith and ideologies is going on in the background, it's not reflected all that much in the diplomacy, and so there isn't much interacting with others at peacetime unless it's trying to fan the flames of war. And again, like I said earlier, war support is maybe just a little too easy to accrue. It should be a bit harder so that you actually have to, yes, develop this momentum to go and declare a justified war. I just wish there was more complexity here overall, just like I do with religion. You know, there are no diplomats or preachers or anything, and while you have to engage with the mechanics, they're not all that engaging in and of themselves. There's a lot of potential for DLC and free updates to add these kinds of systems and complexities, and I really do hope they come. While they're not deal breakers for me, I do feel like they're missed opportunities, and I wouldn't be surprised if the developers decide to add some of these things or make some of these things a bit more fleshed out through just free updates. Again, participating in OpenDev was an eye-opening experience. They really took feedback to heart and made a lot of very big changes, so I wonder if there are plans to, you know, kind of freshen these things up a little bit more and perhaps flesh them out a bit more, or maybe, yes, they are planned as a DLC and free updates through the various hopefully years to come. The game provides an excellent opportunity at crafting stories. The AI provides varying degrees of challenge across a good number of difficulties for folks who are more or less familiar with the genre. And if you're familiar with the genre, you'll be familiar with one of its most problematic points, which is steamrolling. There's always a tipping point. Eventually, you'll start steamrolling the enemy, but on the higher difficulties, it takes quite a bit of effort to get there, at least for myself, so points for that. You will steamroll eventually, but with the higher difficulties again, it takes a while before you can get there. Game settings are varied enough, and there are reasons to play over and over and over again beyond that. Again, the different cultures are very fun to play as, not only because the beautiful background music that changes to match them, but also because they all have slightly different playstyles, and their blends can sometimes result in interesting consequences in how buildings or affinities or legacy traits might interact through the eras. I think it's a beautiful game, both audio-visually and from the perspective of a gameplay experience. There's promise of insane mod support, which is always good to hear, and it's really not hard to see how easily DLC and post-launch support can keep this game alive for years to come. I've had a blast with Humankind. Is it perfect? No. Have I stayed up until sunrise playing it a few times already? You're goddamn right I have. I hope this review has given you some insight into Humankind. From its core concept to its execution, there's a lot of good stuff to enjoy, but I'd love to hear your thoughts too. Do you have an opinion based on what you've seen or played? Any concerns or questions? Leave them in the comments below, and don't hesitate to join our Discord if you're interested in playing some multiplayer or just chatting about the game with a massive, friendly community. Remember, you can grab the game on my store at the link in the description and pinned comment down below, or also using Xbox Game Pass if you're already subscribed to that. And on the topic of subscriptions, don't hesitate to subscribe to this channel for more strategy gaming news, previews, reviews, Let's Plays, and more. As always, a massive thanks goes out to all of the channel members and patrons who've been supporting the channel on a monthly basis. Y'all keep us alive and running smoothly. And of course, a big ol' thanks goes out to each and every one of you for watching. Until next time, cheers.